assessments over the past year and a half, and I wanted to give you a little bit of the history about the origin of that. When the search team was doing the search for our new pastor before we hired Gail, we had her come and join us. During the process of filling out the analysis of ourselves and our self-assessment, one of the things that was brought up continuously is what's our mission. And all of us in the search team said, well, we're not sure what that is. And even if you do have a current mission statement, that's a temporary one. But one of the things that when we were interviewing Gail, that she said during that process, well, the first thing you have to do is find out your why. And so over the past year and a half, we've canvassed a lot of small groups in the congregation as well as groups outside in the community. And that's how this thing got started. So we're here to present the results of that today. Megan's going to talk briefly about how we worked with the community.
So I'm going to start off by framing the conversations, and then Megan's going to fill in some of the stories that occurred during the process. So in the last year and a half, there are a couple meetings that we had. And so we organized, and you'll see on this chart here on the left is what we're calling friends and members, and on the right are neighbors outside the church. Because the purpose of this exercise is really to find out who you are as a community, and not only internally but externally, because you have certain ideas about who you are, but wouldn't it be cool to see if that's actually true out in the community, how people see you? And so this is an exercise to do that. And so the way we started is we had what we call these community conversations. And even just having a conversation were valuable in and of themselves, because within the community, people get to hear what other people are thinking. But also outside the immediate community, with our neighbors, we get to see what they're thinking and how they view the church and how we view the church for them. So out of this then comes these underlying themes, because all of you are here in this church, even though you have very different stories and very different backgrounds, there's something that does connect you all. And so the goal of this exercise is to find that thing that connects you all. But there's also the wider community, the neighbors, who are connected to this church sometimes in some ways, and to find those things that connect between the two groups and what is that underlying theme that is then going to create the framework moving forward in terms of informing what you do as a community, whether that's service, sermons, mission, activities, whatever it is, sort of will be directed by that framework. So there were over 12 sessions, some individual sessions as well, and over 95 people participated in these community conversations. And what we did is, if many of you who participated in it will remember, there were two questions that we asked, and really it wasn't necessarily the questions that were important, it was the conversations that came up out of those questions that were valuable. What we did do, though, is the first question that we asked was one word. If there was one word, the first word that pops into your head when you think of Jackson Community Church, what's that word? And so what we did is we collected those words from all these groups. And what we did is we actually separated them just so you could sort of see what internally you're thinking and how you're thinking it externally. And so what we did is we took those words and we built word clouds. And the larger the word, the more prominent it was, the more frequent it was. And so this is a word cloud that came up as a result of what we're calling friends and members, people who participate in the activities of the church. You'll see community is the largest word. A lot of it is around fellowship, social, caring, friendly, church. But there are some other things around faith and spirit. But during these conversations, they didn't rise to the top as much as these other words. And so here's the word cloud that came out of the conversations with our neighbors. Very similar, actually. Supportive, friendly, welcoming, open, Christmas. We'll talk about it in a second, because I think it's a great opportunity And then here they are together. You can sort of see them and sort of squint and see where some of the commonality is. Obviously, the community is the biggest one that connects the two. So the other thing we did with all this data is we said, okay, let's look at the actual words, some of the words that came up during the conversation, not just the initial words, because the initial words were the first gut thing that people thought about the church. And then as we had the conversations, the people got to listen to each other, they started to think more deeply about their relationship with the church. And so the words that sort of rose to the top from those conversations, we put it in these two columns. And you can see, again, there's a lot of overlap in some of the themes that came out as a result of the conversations subsequent to those questions. Community, people, service, welcome, families. Now, I highlight communication because that is not so much a why, but a what. Okay? Because that from the community came up as a really critical piece. They're really excited about the opportunities and what you're doing as a community, but they don't know. They're not getting connected to the communication around what it is. And they want to connect, but they feel like that's a missing link. So we can talk about that in more detail. So as a result of all of that, we culled it down, and these were sort of the core values that rose to the top that define who you are based on these conversations. And there are really two things. One is community, right? We see that word over and over again in the results. And from that, really, there are a couple of things, themes around that, around common experience, meet people where they are, being welcome, and then having a place for connection, comfort, and peace. And then also, the other thing that connects the neighbors in particular, but all of us, to a place like this is the spectrum of life, or sometimes what I might call the circle of life, right? So everybody is born, many of us get baptized, there are all these transitions through life, and then our passing at the end, and we connect them all back to the church. Whether we're members of the church or members of the community, there always seems to be this connection back to the church, the traditions and rituals. So I'm going to leave it with that. That's sort of the initial findings, and I'm going to let Meg tell some stories, and Gail will follow up with some as well.
I have stories, but I contacted some community members. We came brainstorming about who, you know, might want to be involved, who's part of our community, et cetera, and we asked a cross-section of school parents, community activists, and people that are on committees and boards and so forth in the town, people who own inns, merchants, etc. And obviously, they're always really terribly busy, so it's hard to get them all here. But the whole thing about communication was interesting. We had one innkeeper who said, well, you know, I'd really like to have weddings, but people want to know about the church, blah, 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 blah. And I have a hard time connecting when a bride wants to see the church, do this, do that. Well, you know, we've had the front door open for almost a year now. Mm-hmm. So that gets into the communication and that sort of the thing of, we know that the church is open, we talk about it, but here's somebody who wants to have their people involved. So that was a quick solution to a problem, was to say, you know, that sanctuary that the bride and groom want to look at is open 24/7. So you don't have to be having a full-time staff here at the church to answer your questions that open up the door. The other thing was there was a lot of nostalgia for, which is for everybody who've been here for a very long time. Remember the Jackson Women's Sewing Club and the rummage sales and the preschool, just as they did with the old library and the old school and the old everything. So that was a common thing that I think folks who've been around remember. But they also seem to very much be happy about the church. And we said, what is the church to you? Someone who was completely not involved at all and came because had a nonprofit who was just sort of part of the town. He said, well, I think a village needs a school, a library, a church. It has to be here. And that was kind of the theme, too, whether they want to actively be here or send their in-guests here or send their friends here. They think it's really important. They like us for weddings and funerals and community connectors. And many people have been here for big occasions, like funerals and weddings and things like that. So they certainly see it as an equal part. But as Chris was saying, communication, we know that we send emails out, we feel like we're trying really hard to communicate. But some of the basic things that we all sort of know, clueless. So every single person who came. would you like to be part of that? Every one of them joined up. And Gail said, no one has unsubscribed. They all, they, oh, absolutely. So there is definitely that thirst for knowing what else we're doing here. So that's all I said.
Okay, and we're only sketching a couple of things that we learned. But so one thing was, yes, so some of the people that are our neighbors that we talked to, they don't necessarily even identify, let's say, as Christian. But regardless of whether they identify necessarily with our religious identity, there's a sense of us as a spiritual center, and that we have some gravity, and we are their church. Whatever that means for people, we're their church. A couple of the things that rose up, certainly especially in the conversations with neighbors, included a lot of emphasis on collaboration. Some people have already experienced some positive moments of collaboration. For instance, when we had Robert Aziz come in and speak at the library, and then also be here preaching at the church, the Whitney Center, the school, the library really value collaboration. And so when we talk about meeting people where they are, we're not just talking about meeting people inside the church, right? A lot of what we're doing, and it's not just me, it's everybody that's out there identifying themselves one way or another as belonging to this church or being connected to this church, is meeting people out, you know, on the walk today, or at the Honduras Hope Common Man tent, or collaborating on programming and cultural experiences or enriching things with the library, the community center, and the school. And they're hoping for more of that. So we're hoping that one of the opportunities is to deepen those connections outside the church with the other parts of the community. There's so many people that are connected to the library or the school. And when we are working with them, again, we're outside this building, but we are still the church, and we're deepening those connections. I think that's probably enough for me.
So I'll wrap up. And so another thing to think about, this actually came out of our conversation last night, in observing what we see as we step back and look at these conversations and think about the church. And the church, in a way, is sort of insular, sort of separate from, it's sort of its own thing. But if we think of the church in the community, and what is the community, and how can the church be part of that community, this is a community of hospitality. This is a community where people come on vacation. And how can we use that to inform what we do within the community? So just some food for thought. So then you're all going to ask, now what, right? So what are the next steps? So these are some of the things that will happen next out of this framework that we've developed from this exercise, looking for some framing scripture to help connect it to the Bible and the Word of God. Communication, we've heard that theme before. And then this will then help inform either updating or creating a new mission and vision statement.
Chris, sorry. Framing scripture.
So I will let Gail explain what that means.
Okay.
Good question,
though. Okay, so we go back to our core identity. We are a community church. We have people coming from many different backgrounds, but we do identify ourselves as a Trinitarian church. So we are still based in one specific faith, welcoming everybody and hoping that there's something that you receive from us. And part of that training is to go back to sacred texts and to look at some texts that hold the core values and remind us of our core values and why we're doing this. And we're not just a nonprofit or a social service organization. We're a church. So we're spiritual centered. What expresses for us the why of what we're doing? And where that comes from. So we think that it would be fabulous that, you know, this isn't a top-down exercise. None of this is. This is coming. This church belongs to all of us. And so we would like your input into what, it could be a Mary Oliver poem, it could be a biblical passage, it could be a song, something that speaks to you about this Christ Church is for you. And this why that we have started to talk about, community, friends, caring, and service, and families, and people. What embodies that? And if you would share, we'll get back to you with that kind of stuff, but how the mechanism for doing that. But we would like you to start thinking about that and contribute. So we can share with each other, what does that look like when it becomes a framing scripture for us? Okay?
That's great.
So without any questions, I guess, right? I'd love to wrap it up.
Well, the one thing that I wanted to make a comment about is when we opened it up to the community and had the community's involvement, they were very appreciative of that. They thought this was the first time that we reached out to them like that. And I think that's a good measuring stick of how we're doing with the community, and that we're just trying to get out there and communicate with them.
So with that, we'll leave that with you. There'll be activities that'll be coming that will connect back to this. And I think there'll be other opportunities in terms of an exercise around developing some framing scripture and how we communicate and what we do to communicate and developing mission and vision. There are other projects that may come out of it. One of the other things that we wanted to make sure is that we knew, right? So there's this other exercise with Doug Bixby, right, that you guys have done, where sort of moving from committees to champions and sort of developing a different way of operating. And so this is a way of reinforcing that. So we're building on that. Right? So all these things that we're doing are building on each other, right? And so there will be some opportunities. There'll probably be a bunch of projects that will come out of this, and when a champion rises to take on one of those projects, then they will continue. As opposed to saying, here are the projects we're going to make committees for all of them, and right. So that's a different way of thinking about how that gets implemented through that process that was developed through the work with that thing.
In other words, like, you know, let the church be a connector of champions to causes.
Right.
We will support, but we don't have to invent all the causes, and there's plenty of causes already out there, and there's lots of nonprofits. We don't have to create a nonprofit or invent the whole thing. We can support the things that we're already passionate for, but when we connect into the church, they'll last as long as there are champions that have the energy and passion to put into them. And they don't have way. So this doesn't tie us to anything specific. There are things that are simmering that we do have our hands in, but it leaves a great opening.
And each one of those activities then will tie back to that framework and our core values. So what the most important part of all of this is that there are these core values. And it's not about the things we do, but it's how we support those core values through the things we do. Okay?
Thank you.